centers, basically. They start from the mosque. You go daily to pray or during the Friday prayers, whether you go to the Temple Mount, whether you go to the local mosque. And this is not only in the Palestinian areas. This is all throughout the Middle East. It's been going on from the eons of time. And it is an eschatological teaching regarding the destruction of the State of Israel, regarding the destruction of the Jewish people. Basically, an Islamic country, they consider the Israel as an Islamic country, and once an Islamic foothold was there before in the past, it must never be occupied by a non-Muslim country. So the eradication of the Jewish people is taught in the eschatological norm, in the schools, in the mosques, in the centers, everywhere you go. So from all aspects of life, if you go walk in the streets and see the graffiti around you, things like we knock on the gates of heaven with the skulls of Jews, this is the kind of mentality that they have. And I always ask myself the question, what does knocking on the gates of heaven with the skulls of Jews have anything to do with the political desire to establish a state called Palestine? Palestine has become sort of a psychosis in a way. This is why we have Hamas now. It's escalated to the point that it's growing its tentacles all throughout the Middle East, Iran, in Pakistan. The majority of Pakistanis want an Islamist state.
But so, when you were a teenager, I mean, you didn't know all this as a teenager. You were, what, 16 when you joined the PLO? Why did you want to join this organization, and did you realize that you were about to get involved with a group that was going to kill innocent people?
Well, you have to understand, you joined at 5 years old, going to school. We sang a song, all the school children sang, Al-Arab Ihbabna wal-Yahud Kilabna, which means Arabs are beloved and Jews are dogs. So right, even going to a Christian school, we learned that Jesus was a Palestinian revolutionist. So from the biblical perspective and the Quranic perspective, all the religion was used as a base for teaching revolution. This is the dogma that they teach. So when you go, by the time I went to high school, that's when we learned the eradication of the Jewish people, when the stones and the trees will cry out, there's a Jew hiding behind me, come and kill him. So it's really, in a nutshell, the problem is a massive racist ideology that is growing throughout the Middle East and the Muslim world.
So tell me what you did and how active you got. I mean, what was the worst act of terrorism you committed while an active member of the PLO?
I planted a bomb in Bank Laomi, Israel, in Bethlehem, nearly lynched an Israeli soldier, was in every demonstration from the Temple Mount in the streets of our village, everywhere, you know. The whole community becomes imbued with this way of life. So stonings and you name it. I mean, I ended up in prison, and there I was recruited to do a bomb operation of a bank. My recruiter put 15 explosive charges in Israel, and he was being bailed out by Israeli lawyers. It's as ironic as it sounds, that's how it was. Israel was a democracy, so allowed even to get those prisoners out. My cousins also got involved in terrorism. They were also released with the UN deals and this kind of thing. So you have thousands of terrorists being thrown back into the streets and with this UN agreement.
Now, you remain this active life of terrorism overseas, but you also came to the U.S. and you were a part of the Muslim Brotherhood in Chicago.
That's right.
Tell me how you were able to carry on terrorist activities, and how did you do it here in the U.S.?
Well, in the U.S., I didn't do any terrorist activities, but it was the recruitment of the preparation for jihad in America. My recruiter was, his name is Jamal Saeed. He's a colleague of Abdullah Azzam, the mentor of Osama bin Laden. Ironically speaking, Jamal Saeed is free in a mosque in Bridgeview, Illinois. The IAP started as a result, Islamic Association of Palestine. And they was, after that, I left that organization. And then after that, there was training. The head of the IAP was caught in training how to manufacture car bombs and things like that. So it was, I have clips, homemade videos that if I show your audience, it will come out of Gaza or it will come out of Iran. I mean, this stuff was happening in the heartland of America, all over in Chicago, in DeKalb, in Georgia, all over the United States. It was going on in the mosque, and it's going on right now.
So did 9/11 surprise you?
No, as a matter of fact, in 1993, I started my first mission in 1993, speaking in churches and synagogues. And people didn't want to believe me when I said they're going to blow up your buildings. These people are interested in decapitating Americans. And this is too much for us to fathom. Nobody was listening. After September 11, I started getting more phone calls.
Did you ever feel guilty?
Yes, I did. I started studying basically the history. You have to understand, in the Arab mentality in the Middle East, from the beginning of Mahmoud Abbas, who's considered secular, all the way to the fundamentalists, the denial of the Holocaust is the premise of this education. So we deny the Holocaust ever existed. So when we're seeing the, if we see the footage of the Holocaust in the Middle East, we say, well, how did they have such scrawny bodies? What kind of a diet plan were they on? Because the whole thing was an enactment. It wasn't reality. This is an enactment to establish the Zionist state. In Germany, it's illegal to deny the Holocaust, but yet in the Middle East, denial of the Holocaust is flourishing. So the moment I started getting a good grip that the Holocaust was a historic reality, I started to understand that evil cloaks itself in nice fabricated fashions. Evil cloaks itself just like Nazism does, that it's a good cause. Israel becomes a vermin. The Jews are vermin. This is why Nasrallah doesn't apologize for killing Jewish children. He only apologizes when Arab children are dying in Israel proper by his rocket launchings. Why is that? Why does Nasrallah apologize for killing only Arab children? And the answer is very simple. The problem is racism. Racism on a pandemic scale all throughout the Middle East and the Muslim world, all the way to Pakistan, all the way to Indonesia, all the way to the Philippines, all the way in Jordan, all the way in Cairo, all the way in Syria,
So, Waleed, let me ask you, you had an epiphany. You decided this isn't the way to go about finding peace. You decided to completely step away from any acts of terrorism or any organizations or any association. But when you look at all these groups, I mean, whether it be Hezbollah, Hamas, Islamic Jihad, Iraqi insurgents, there are so many, and it is so strong, and it is all across the world. I mean, how do you reach those people? How do you even gain the understanding that this is not going to achieve peace?
We have to understand, terrorism is a cult-like education to convert masses of people to become remorseless killers. And it's like a drug addiction. It feeds on a frenzy-like speeches. It galvanizes people in a euphoric fashion, where an Israeli, when he's killed, they come out with the blood and they carry guts and hearts and kidneys and parade them in the streets of Ramallah. This is a drug addiction that is permeating the teenagers of the Middle East. We have to treat it as such. We have to go to the drug pushers. We have to go to the source of the problem. We don't solve the problem by simply destroying Hezbollah only, but we solve the problem by going to the mosques where the manufacturing of these, this education is going on. We need to fire the clergy. We need to understand that this type of Islam that's being taught in the Middle East and being taught in America as well is not a religion. Once it goes beyond that boundary, it becomes a government system and becomes a civil code that wants to establish itself universally throughout the whole world. Once we understand that, we understand to deal with it just as we deal with drugs.
Waleed Shabbat, the book is Why I Left Jihad. Fascinating perspective, Waleed. I appreciate your time today.
Thank you for having me.
Well, some call him a typical teen. Police call him the prime suspect.